Morning and welcome to our service today. Today we talk about light and darkness, that contrast of living in the darkness versus living in the light of the glory and the forgiveness of Jesus. And so we sing our first hymn, which tells us that Jesus is the one who brings us into the light. Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
We have come into the presence of God, who created us to love and serve him as his dear children. But we have disobeyed him and deserve only his wrath and his punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to him and plead for his mercy. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin and take away my guilt. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all of your sins. By the perfect life and the innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he has removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. And may God give you strength to live according to his will.
Amen.
And in the peace of our forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. Jesus Christ, by your almighty power, you opened the eyes of the blind and showed yourself to them.
Turn our eyes away from worthless things and lead us to love you sincerely. For you live and you reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our Old Testament reading for this, the fourth Sunday in Lent, is written in Isaiah chapter 42. Isaiah writes these words before the Jews are taken into captivity. And so he is telling the Jews that he will, those repentant Jews, he will bring them back to Jerusalem. He will provide them light their way as they bring him back to their city. To those Jews who continue to follow other gods and not worship him, he promises that he will keep them in blindness and in darkness. And so for us too, we repent of our sins so that we may live in the light of Jesus and not continue to live in darkness. And so God is talking here to his people. I have been silent for a long time. I have kept still. I have restrained myself. But now, like a woman giving birth, I will scream. I will gasp and pant. I will dry up mountains and hills. I will make all their grass wither. I will turn rivers into islands. I will dry up pools. I will lead the blind on a way they do not know. Along paths they do not know, I will direct them. Ahead of them, I will turn darkness into light and rough places into level ground. These are the things I will accomplish for them. I will not abandon them. They will be turned back and completely disgraced, those who trust in an idol, those who say to molten images, "You are our gods." You deaf ones, listen. You blind ones, watch carefully so that you can see. Who is as blind as my servant? Who is as deaf as my messenger whom I sent? Who is as blind as my associate, as blind as a servant of the Lord? You Israel see many things, but you do not observe. Israel opened his ears, but he does not hear. Because of his own righteousness, the Lord was pleased to make his law great and glorious. This is our Old Testament reading. Our psalm today is Psalm 27, and we will hear the refrain, sing the refrain, and read responsively. Whom shall I fear?
The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
One thing I ask from the Lord.
This only do I seek.
That I may dwell in the house of the Lord.
All the days of my life.
To gaze on the beauty of the Lord. Shelter of his sacred tent. I remain confident of this.
I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living.
Wait for the Lord.
Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Ephesians chapter 5,
Here again, Paul talks about light and darkness. He says we were in the darkness, but now we live in the light, so let's keep on walking in that light. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. Try to learn what is pleasing to the Lord, and do not participate in the fruitless deeds of darkness. Instead, expose them. For it is shameful even to mention the things that are done by people in secret. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, for it is light that makes things visible. Therefore it is said, "Awake, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." This is our epistle reading. I'm in Lent out of respect for the sufferings of Jesus. We skipped Alleluias. So let's rise for the gospel lesson. The Holy Gospel today is written in the 9th chapter of St. John's Gospel. In this lesson, Jesus heals a man who was born blind and then opens his spiritual eyes so that he can see him as the Messiah. As Jesus was passing by, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "It was not this man that sinned, or his parents, but that God's works might be revealed in connection with him. I must do the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." After saying this, Jesus spit on the ground, made some mud with the saliva, and spread the mud on the man's eyes. "Go," Jesus told him, "wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. So he went and washed and came back seeing. They brought this man who had been blind to the Pharisees. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. So the Pharisees also asked him how he received his sight. "He put mud on my eyes," the man told them. "I washed and now I see." Then some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God because he does not keep the Sabbath." Others were saying, "How can a sinful man work such miraculous signs?" And there is division among them. So they said to the blind man again, "What do you have to say about him because he opened your eyes?" The man replied, "He is a prophet." They answered him, "You are entirely born in sinfulness, yet you presume to teach us?" And they threw him out. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out. When he found him, he asked, "Do you believe in the Son of God?" "Who is he, sir?" the man replied, "that I may believe in him." Jesus answered, "You have seen him, and he is the very one who is speaking with you." Then he said, "Lord, I believe," and he knelt down and worshipped him. Jesus said, "For judgment I came into this world, in order that those who do not see will see, and those who do see will become blind." This is the gospel of our Lord. Maybe seated, and we'll have the kids' sermon. Today I brought a scarf. And what happens if I take off my glasses and I take this scarf and I do this with it? Can't see, right? Somewhere, but I can't really see where he is. That's what happens when I put this scarf on and it's just darkness, isn't it? Well, some people can't see, even if they don't have a scarf on, because they're blind. And it's hard then, it's more difficult for them, and they have to learn how to get through life by doing other things so that they can know what's around them. And we heard in our lesson that I just read about a man who was born blind. He could not see from the time he was born, but Jesus came and did that miracle. He said Jesus put mud on his eyes, told him to wash, and then he could see all of a sudden. So Jesus healed him so that he had sight. In that same reading, we heard about people who were called Pharisees, and they could see, Jesus, but they didn't want to believe in him. They didn't want to see him as the Savior. And so even though they could see with their eyes, with their mind is kind of blind about who Jesus is. Now, it's just the opposite for us, right? We can't see Jesus with these eyes right now. Someday we will when we get to heaven, but right now we can't see Jesus. But we believe he's here. We believe he's always with us. We believe he died for us, and so that's how we see him. We see him with the eyes of faith, we say. And so Jesus gave us that faith so that we can believe him and see him. And we thank him for that faith, and we want to keep, as we've been saying, keep walking in that light of Jesus. So let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for opening our eyes of faith so that we can believe you as our Savior. Help us to keep walking in that, keep trusting you as our Savior, and help us to let other people know that so that they can see the light of you as the Savior. We pray this in your name. Amen. You guys can go back and sit down, and we'll sing our next hymn. Epistle for today, and I'll read the first and last part again. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. And then at the end it says, therefore it is said, awake, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. This is the word of God. May you see. Dear friends in Christ, so today we've been talking about light and darkness, and I'd like to begin with this question, is light good or is light bad? Sometimes it kind of depends, right? If you're sound asleep in your bedroom at nine and it's all dark and then someone comes into your room and flips on a light that's on a nightstand right next to you, you're going like, oh man, turn that light off, I was sleeping. Then that's not the light that we want, right? Or if you would get arrested on suspicion of some serious crime and the police would take you into the questioning room and they'd have you handcuffed to the table and then they'd shine that bright light in your eyes and say, all right, talk, we would be like, oh, it's too bright, can you turn that light off? And that would not be a good light. But normally, usually when we're talking about light and darkness, light is good. Light is what helps us to see so that we know what's around us, we know what's going on, so that we don't bump into things. And as we said in the children's sermon, if we would have to live in blindness, that would be a difficult disability for us, wouldn't it? Well, today we're not just talking about physical light and darkness, but spiritual light and darkness. And so then again, the question, is spiritual light good or it is bad? Well, the devil tries very hard to get us to think that spiritual light is bad. And living in spiritual goodness, as spiritual darkness, is good, and it's a lot of fun. But Paul makes very clear in our text today that if we live in spiritual darkness, it's all kinds of trouble for us. And it is a blessing for us to live in the light. In fact, Jesus said in our gospel lesson today, I am the light of the world. And so what a blessing it is for us to know Jesus, to live in his light. And our theme today then is to let that light, not the sun that's so bright today, but the sun, the light of Jesus, let that light shine on us. First of all, we see how he brought us into the light, and then he helps us to keep walking in the light. So let's go back and review or remind ourselves, when the Bible talks about spiritual darkness, what is it talking about? And mainly two things. One is sin, the darkness of sin. And we see that in our text that says, do not participate in the fruitless deeds of darkness, instead expose them, for it is shameful even to mention the things that are done by people in secret. So sinful things are the things that people don't want to be exposed, don't want other people to know about. They're shameful, they're sinful, they're embarrassing, they're disgraceful. And that's why people do them in the dark, so they don't get caught. So they don't get exposed. So that's one thing the Bible's talking about when it's talking about darkness. The other thing is the darkness of unbelief, of not knowing Jesus. And we said earlier, the devil just tries to get us to live in that darkness and to stay in that darkness. The devil tries to get us to think that the deeds of darkness are going to be fun for us. We should do that. Or the devil tries to get us to think that God is not real, that he's mean, that he's ancient, that he's out of touch, that he doesn't love us, that he doesn't exist for us, to just turn off that light of Jesus. In doing that, then, he tries to get us to think that the only thing in our life is us. It's all about us. No matter what other people think or want or care or want us to do, that's not important. It's all about me and what I want for my life and how I want to live my life. And so the devil just tries to keep people in that darkness of unbelief. And you know, the weird thing about all of this is people can be very smart about all kinds of things, but still live in the darkness if they don't know Jesus. And we see a perfect example of that in our gospel lesson today from John chapter 9, where Jesus healed that man who was born blind. And we mentioned that in the children's sermon. And we had to cut out verses for that gospel lesson to make it all fit. But it's an interesting read just to go and read that whole chapter, especially that discussion between the man who was born blind and the Pharisees. And So the Pharisees don't want to believe in Jesus, and they want to accuse him of breaking the Sabbath, and they keep questioning this guy. How do you see, or what do you think about this guy? And he just keeps coming back and saying, well, I couldn't see, and now I can see, so I think he's a prophet. And they're like, he's not a prophet. And then he says, I think that you want to be his disciples, and that makes them really mad. And that's when they say, you know, we know Moses, and you lecture us. How dare you? And so there's people today who are so smart about all kinds of things, about science, about medical things, and economics, and literature, all kinds of things. But if they don't know Jesus, they're just walking around in the darkness, and that's so sad. Paul says we were once like that, and if we didn't know Jesus, we would still be walking around in the darkness. It's like those prison movies when the alarm goes off because someone is not in his cell, and the guards up in the towers are shining their lights all around the yard and all around outside of the perimeter, and so we're that prisoner who escaped. And when the light comes, we're like up against the wall so that we don't get that light shine on us. And so without Jesus, that would be our life, trying to hide in the darkness so that we would not be exposed. Every once in a while, we hear about someone who gets into trouble because of something on their computer. I just saw that headline just this week again. Think of what it would be like for us if every email we ever sent or every text we ever sent would be out there for everyone to see. Or every word we ever said, or every thought that we ever had in our mind was out there for everyone to see and know, to be exposed by all. And we would live in that shame. How would we hide that from God? It's kind of like Adam and Eve trying to hide in the bushes after they sinned. That didn't work out very well for them, did it? Because God easily found them. And so there's no way that we can hide our sins from God. They are exposed to him because he knows all and sees all. And how do we come back from that? We realize then there's no way we can. We need help. We need a Savior. And that Savior is Jesus, who is the light of the world. And actually, we can say every one of our sins is exposed on the cross on Good Friday. When we see Jesus suffering on the cross, he's suffering there because of every one of our sins. It's like that hymn verse, that Lent hymn that says, if you think of sin but lightly, nor suppose the evil great, here you see its nature rightly, here its guilt may estimate, mark the sacrifice appointed, see who bears the awful load, 'tis the Word, the Lord's anointed, Son of Man and Son of God. Jesus suffered in the dark on Good Friday for the darkness of our sins. And then days later, as the Easter sun arose, then Jesus was shown to be alive. Jesus conquered death with his light. And so, yes, Jesus and the devil were engaged in this life and death struggle on Good Friday. And yes, Jesus lost his life, although he said, I laid down my life. But then Jesus conquered death. It wasn't a struggle between two equal powers. Who's going to win this? Because Jesus is the light. And his light burst through. And through his resurrection, he's shown to be the Savior. And then Jesus brought us into the light. As Paul says, therefore it is said, awake, sleeper, rise from the dead. Jesus shone his light into us to give us the light of faith so that we can know Jesus by faith. And again, this is not just some kind of a process. Sometimes it may seem like that in people, but it's not really like, well, I'm an unbeliever, and now I'm maybe half a Christian and maybe not half a Christian. Maybe I have faith yet, and maybe I don't have faith, like someone turning up a dimmer switch. But when Jesus says, arise, it is that word of Jesus that gives us life. It's the power of Jesus' word that brought us to faith through baptism, or if it was just through the Bible Jesus' power of his word brought us to faith. It's not that we first woke up and then Jesus shined his light on us. It's the light of Jesus that woke us up from spiritual blindness to know him by faith. And so now we know our Savior. We know God is real. We know he's love. We know that Jesus conquered the darkness for us, that he rose from the dead, that he brought light into us. We know that Jesus is the light and we are light. And that's then where Paul continues and says, you once are darkness, now you are light. So continue to walk in that light. Do we remember what it was like for us when we lived in the darkness before we were believers? For most of the Ephesians, they did. Because it was only recently in their life that they were converted. They heard Paul preach to them, or some of Paul's co-workers bring the gospel to them, and so they were brought from the darkness of worshiping idols made out of metal and stone and wood to believing in Jesus. They remembered what it was like. Most of us, if we were baptized as little babies, we don't remember what it was like before we were baptized. But we still know now what it is to fall back into the darkness of sin. We still know now what it is to get sucked in by the devil. And so Paul says, don't go back to that darkness. Keep walking in the light. He mentions two ways of doing that. One is to stay away from those deeds of darkness. He says, test what is good. He says, for the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. Try to learn what is pleasing to the Lord. Now, this is not some difficult puzzle we have to figure out or some secret code we have to break. What is pleasing to the Lord? It's pretty clear in his word. What is pleasing to him? What he wants us to do? And so Paul then says, let's stay away from those deeds of darkness and don't go back to them. Do not participate in the fruitless deeds of darkness. Instead, expose them, for it is shameful even to mention the things that are done by people in secret. Don't continue to walk in there. Don't go back to the darkness. He says it's fruitless, it's pointless, it's shameful. No fruit comes from that. We're not bringing forth fruits of faith if we're walking in the darkness. We're not giving glory to Jesus, but instead to let our light shine and bring glory to him. And he says even expose that darkness. That's not always fun to point out to people if this is dark or that's dark, especially in this world where everything goes. But it's not entirely and so much about pointing at people in a judgmental way and say, well, that's wrong and that's wrong and that's wrong. But instead, it's more about letting our light shine so that people may see Christ in us, so that they may see the light and the love of Jesus in us, because that's the main goal, right? So that people know Jesus and see him and live in him. And so that's one way. Paul says, don't go back to those deeds of darkness. The other thing he says is wake up. Because the thing that people do in the dark is sleep. And so in our text, the last verse again, awake, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine in you. So unbelievers are totally spiritually asleep. We are believers now, but he says, let's not get sleepy in our faith. Does it ever happen that we lose that joy and that light of our salvation, and that we feel like our faith is flickering a bit, or it's getting dim? He says, let's wake up from that sleep, that spiritual sleep. And he promises the light of Christ will shine in us. Jesus promises that he is the light, and he will shine in us. That same Christ who carried our deeds of darkness to the cross and paid for them, that same Christ who burst forth in the light of his resurrection, that same Christ who brought us to faith and brought us into the light, promises that he will shine in us. And to live in that light is to have a relationship with Jesus, to walk in him and know him, and we do that through his word. Because his word is his light and his lamp that shines in our hearts. And he asks us to trust that power of his word, to live in that word so that we may hear it and grow it and let that light shine in us. And we'll hear that promise again at the end of our service. when I say to you, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. It's not just Jesus saying to us, have a good week, but it's Jesus saying to us, I will shine in you as you remain in me and my word. Amen. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ our Savior. Amen. And let's join in confessing our faith. We use the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's remain standing. Give thee but thine own, whate'er the gift may be. All that we have is thine alone, a trust, O Lord, from thee. May we thy bounties thus, as stewards true receive, and gladly as thou blessest us, to thee our first fruits give. Amen. And let us pray. O dearest Jesus, we confess that it is our sins that brought you to the cross, where you suffered hell for us and for every sinner. At your own invitation, we take refuge in your wounds and seek cleansing in your blood. By the sacrifice that you made for us, stir us up to love you, to do good works, and to walk in the light of your presence. Dear Holy Spirit, beloved author of our faith, call to our remembrance the sacrifice Christ made for us, lest failing to remember, we fall into unbelief and all manner of sin and vice. Open our mouths to bear witness to our Savior's name, and let the joy of our salvation in Christ fill our hearts and our minds until that day when we rejoice to meet him in glory. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, our God of mercy and love, we commend to your spiritual care all who are afflicted, all who need your help and encouragement, and all who need your healing. Provide for all your children according to their individual needs. We praise your name now and forever, O true and only God, in Jesus' name. And in his name we also pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Are you seated? We'll sing our next hymn.
Thank you.
you for teaching us the things you want us to believe and do. Help us by your Holy Spirit to keep your word in pure hearts, that we may be strengthened in faith, guided in holiness, and comforted in life and in death. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, go in peace, live in harmony with one another, and serve the Lord with gladness. And the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. And the Lord look on you with his favor and give you his peace. Youth group candy bar bingo this evening at 6 o'clock, so we hope you can join us. Our Wednesday service is in Manchester this week. Final steps led to a fig tree, the power of Jesus' word as he curses that fig tree. And we thank the youth group and the Sunday school teachers for hosting our fellowship. And then choir, if you can stay after, we'll sing through the Easter musical. That's before we head home, if you can. And any birthdays or anniversaries today? Russ? All fingers point to you. Happy birthday. When's that?
Friday.
Okay. Okay. Yes. Happy. On Tuesday, Dad's birthday. Happy birthday, Dad. Okay. Gonna have a party for him, Abby? She's gone. Anyone else? Okay, everyone have a good week.